canyon is holy ground. Let's stand up and sing holy ground this morning, folks. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the
worship with you this morning, to worship the one true and living God in the name of Jesus. What a great privilege and responsibility that we have this morning. I just want to start off with a few announcements as we get started. First of all, I think there's some kind of football game going on today, but we are going to have service tonight for anybody who wants to come. And in fact, the service is going to be at 6:30, not at 7. So we talked about this in our most recent members meeting, and then just last Sunday night, I mentioned that we'll go ahead and start doing this meeting at 6:30 on Sunday night. So we didn't get the change in the bulletin, but maybe between Alex and I and Jane Ann, we can remember next week to get that change to 6:30. So we'll have the worship service, Children in Action, 6:30 tonight. And just take a look at the bulletin and see the other things going on. There is this serving at Lowe's and Fish's on Monday. What time is the bus leaving for that? 4:00. Okay. So if you want to take part in that, they're going to leave at 4:00. Anything else that I might be missing needs to be mentioned? Okay. Well, before we do our reading from the Baptist Faith Message, we do want to have a special prayer time for our El Salvador team. So from our church, Karen Pope and Al Groner are going, and there's a handful of others. Al's not here today, but Karen's here somewhere. Where are you, Karen? Karen, you want to go ahead and come forward, and we just want to take a time to lay hands on Karen. Remind me, what's the day that you guys are leaving? On Tuesday, okay. And so they're going to be doing evangelism there. That's something that Karen's going to be taking part in. And there's also some building projects. And is that about the bulk of it, the building project and evangelism?
Yes.
Okay. So we want to pray for Karen. I'll lead us in a prayer, but I invite any of you, if you want to come and lay hands on Karen. It's always something we want to pray for as far as safety and traveling, but also just that the Lord will minister through them. And it'll be nice to warm up a little bit too, won't it? All right, let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for Karen and Al and for everyone else on this team that are heading to El Salvador. We thank you for this opportunity as this is a place that they return to again and again. They're able to pick up on ministry that was left off from previous visits. And of course, there's this ongoing ministry there that they're taking part in. And so we just pray, Lord, that you will bless their time there. We do pray that you give them safe travels and that everything will go smoothly so that they can minister most effectively. But whatever kinks there might be, Lord, we know that you have a purpose in them. So I just pray, Lord, that that they will trust you as they go on this journey, as they head to El Salvador to minister, to bring the gospel to others. We pray, Lord, that that seeds will be planted and even that that fruit will be harvested, Lord, that the people will come to faith and that your kingdom will advance there in El Salvador. So we pray your blessings upon this trip. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Karen, how many in all are going?
Seven
of you. Okay, very good. And that's a trip with the Bethel Baptist Association, by the way, in case you didn't know. So it's a trip that is the many churches in our association are all taking part of. So let's go ahead and read our reading from the Baptist Faith and Message. So we are on the Holy Spirit now, so we've done a reading on God and the nature and character of God, the Trinity, and the Father, Son, and so now we are on the Holy Spirit, and let's read this together. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God, fully divine. He inspired holy men of old to write the Scriptures. Through illumination, he enables men to understand truth. He exalts Christ. He convicts men of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. He calls men to the Savior and effects regeneration. At the moment of regeneration, he baptizes every believer into the body of Christ. He cultivates Christian character, comforts believers, and bestows spiritual gifts by which they serve God through his church. He seals the believer unto the day of final redemption. His presence in the Christian is the guarantee that God will bring the believer into the fullness of the stature of Christ. He enlightens and empowers the believer and the church in worship, evangelism, and service. You know, one thing that's very important as we talk about the Holy Spirit, oftentimes we're tempted to say it, right? The Holy Spirit, it does such and such. But it says he, because the Holy Spirit is a person, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, all persons of the Trinity. And so that's just an important tidbit there. Well, let's go ahead and go on to our time of prayer requests. So Brett's going to come and share what prayer requests we might have.
Good morning. Beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? Okay, the prayer request, we've got quite a few this morning. And as a reminder, the list is right outside the sanctuary here. So if there's ever any need that you have, then make sure you put it on the list so that we can voice those during the service. The first one is Barb Kindred with cancer. And I see that Barbara is with us this morning. It's nice to have you with us. Faye Inslin, she had a stroke and hospice has been called in. David Stone with cancer. Jan Thompson with cancer. Cheryl Kinzer, serious illness. Doug Wagner with his continuing tremors. Robert Newton, he had a heart attack Wednesday. Rosa Newton, ongoing cancer. And then we have a prayer request for an unsaved family member. And then an unspoken request. And Nancy Heimer, which is Janet's sister, the beginning of dementia.
All right, so a lot of burdens there on our hearts. And so this is the time for us to take those burdens to the Lord. We're going to have a time of silent prayer where we can come to the Lord with our requests, but also with our confession. It's the time for us to prepare our hearts for worship. And so let's bow our heads and pray together silently. Dear Lord, all of these prayer requests for health needs remind us of how frail we are. So may we always rely upon you. May we always focus on that which is most important. I pray, Lord, for these people, for many other requests, many other needs that may have not been mentioned. We trust you, Lord. We trust you to work in and through those things. We ask that you do so for your glory, for our good. We pray that as we continue in this service, that you would mold us through song, through prayer, by your word. We pray, Lord, that your spirit would work among us. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I want us to meditate this morning on a couple verses from Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It says, "Guard your steps when you go to the house of God. To draw near to listen is better than to offer the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they are doing evil. Be not rash with your mouth, nor let your heart be hasty to utter a word before God, for God is in heaven, and you are on the earth. Therefore, let your words be few." And so I just want to encourage us this morning, as we come together on a weekly basis to worship and to study God's word, that we don't do it rashly, that we don't do it complacently, but that we really stop and come slowly before the throne and examine our hearts and make sure that we're really coming before God in a heart of worship. So with that, I want to encourage you to stand, and we will worship this morning, but be conscious of that reality as we are singing these songs and hearing this word.
Wrestling and in my doubt, in my failure, she won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, she won't let go. In the question, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Sure. I won't fear what tomorrow brings with God's lover, lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness.
Offering all of me, Jesus.
Jesus, you're all this heart is living for.
Father, just thank you for this day. Thank you for the beautiful weather you've given us. Come this morning to worship and praise you and through the beauty of these tithes and offerings. Ask you to do with it as you see fit. As always, I pray that we please you and glorify you in the things we do. I lift it up to you.
So as we're continuing in worship this morning, I want to bring our attention to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. It says, "But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved." And so as we sing these next couple songs talking about our salvation and the hope we have in Christ, let us remember that it's his love for us that gives us hope and that really gives us security in every single passing day. So if you would please stand and we will continue worshiping together this morning.
Behold the man upon
For truth time. This morning we're going to be talking about the Holy Spirit, what we read about this morning. But first I want to ask you guys a question. Have any of you ever helped your parents or your grandparents or anyone like that on any kind of like a project? Like have you ever, you know, built a birdhouse together or anything like that? Has anybody done any kind of like project or anything like that? Nobody? Nobody's built anything, no crafts, no special projects, no nothing. Well, I know there were a couple projects that I would help my dad on, or I would help maybe my grandpa on, like if he was working in the yard, maybe if he had some kind of special project or something. But it was never something that I could do on my own, right? Like if I was a little kid, I probably wouldn't be left in charge of doing all the landscaping for my parents' house. That was something that I would help with, but not necessarily something that I would be doing by myself. So we work on special projects, or we do certain things maybe with our parents or our grandparents or somebody, or maybe here at church, you know, during your different classes or times, maybe there's special projects that your teacher helps you on or things like that. And so we're going to talk just a little bit about how the Holy Spirit helps us as Christians. So I want to read a couple of Bible verses for you this morning. It's in John chapter 14, it's verses 25 and 26, and this is what it says. This is Jesus speaking to his disciples. He says, "These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you." So what Jesus is talking about here is how the Holy Spirit, after he ascended and went back up into heaven, so after Jesus died, we know that he rose from the grave, and then after he rose from the grave, a little while after that, he ascended, he went back up into heaven, and he said that after he went up into heaven, he would send the Holy Spirit to help those of us who believe in him, who are God's children, who put our faith and trust in Jesus and are saved. And so the awesome thing is, you know, this life, there's all kinds of super difficult things, you know, that we have to do that as Christians, things that really are impossible for us to do on our own, trials that we have to overcome, or just different things that we're called to do that Jesus wants us to do that are really, it's really impossible for us to do on our own, but the Holy Spirit is the one who's given to us to help us to do the things that we need to do and to obey Jesus in every aspect of our life, okay? So it's kind of hard to understand that, but it says that he actually lives in us if we're believers, that he is with us, that he dwells in us in our hearts, okay? So I want to encourage you all that I hope that you all have already made a decision for Jesus, but if you haven't, know that God gives us his very own Holy Spirit to comfort us when we're sad, to teach us new things, and to help us do everything that we're supposed to do in this life as Christians, okay? Does that message maybe make a little more sense than the one last week? You guys acted like you didn't understand what I was saying last week, so I hope maybe that one makes a little more sense. All right, so anyway, you guys are dismissed to go down to Sunday school, so thank you all very much.
It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down again. God gave his only son to win. His erring child he reconciled. You and I parting from our sin. Shout. so sure I shall still endure all measureless and strong. Redeeming grace to Adam's race shall be the saints and angels' song. Filled, were the skies of parchment made? Were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade? To write the love of God above, would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole. Go stretch from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, our ancient. It shall forevermore endure. How measureless and strong, saints and angels song.
To Exodus chapter 16. We're going to be in Exodus 16, verses 1 through 12 this morning. And I've titled this sermon, The Problem with Grumbling. At our house, in our living room, we have some verses up on our wall. It's we haven't got all the way through the alphabet, but it's the ABCs, and so there's a verse for each letter of the alphabet. And so for the letter D, our verse is, do all things without grumbling or disputing. Philippians 2:14. We really like to drive that one in to the kids whenever we go through those verses. Do all things without grumbling or disputing. Now, why is that so important? Why is it important that we not grumble? Well, that's what we're going to see in our text this morning. Last week, we talked about grumbling a little bit. We saw in the account of Marah, right, when the people of Israel come to this watering hole, they grumble because the water is bitter. But then we see that God graciously performs a miracle and makes the water sweet. But we see that theme of grumbling even in our text last week, but it's even more prominent this week. And so we're going to read the text in a moment. What I want you to do as we read it, I want you to count how many times the word grumbling or grumble or some form of that word, how many times it appears. And I'll just give you a hint. If you're holding your Bible with one hand and you're counting on the other hand, you're going to have to start all over after you get to five, because there's more than five, okay? But why don't you go ahead and stand with me as we read God's word together. And really, I want you to count on your fingers how many times we come across this word. So chapter 16, beginning in verse 1. They set out from Elim, and all the congregation of the people of Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the people of Israel said to them, would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full, for you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then the Lord said to Moses, behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you, And the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may test them whether they will walk in my law or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily. So Moses and Aaron said to the people of Israel, at evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against the Lord. For what are we that you would grumble against us? And Moses said, when the Lord gives you in the evening meat to eat, and in the morning bread to the full, because the Lord has heard your grumbling, that you grumble against him, what are you? What are we? Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord. Then Moses said to Aaron, say to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, come near before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling. And as soon as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. And the Lord said to Moses, I have heard the grumbling of the people of Israel. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall be filled with bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. All right, so how many times?
Eight.
Very good. Good job. Let's pray together. God, we pray that as we look at this text, as we learn maybe what not to do from the people of Israel, but as we also see some teachings and principles for us in this passage, we pray that that your Spirit would apply that to our hearts, that we would live it out, that this would be something that sticks with us, something that changes us from the inside out, as we consider how you would have us respond to trials and discomforts. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so we're going to look at just a couple of reasons why grumbling is such a problem. But before we do that, just a couple of things in verse 1 that I think we should point out. First of all, on the surface, it might sound like it's been 2 months and 15 days, which that's still not a very long time. It might sound like it's been 2 months and 15 days since the people of Israel had left Egypt. But a closer examination shows us it's actually just been about a month. So when it says that it's the 15th day of the second month, it's not saying since, it says after, but and that's what make it sound confusing. It's not saying that it's been 2 months and 15 days since they left Egypt, but it's just in the second month. So like, for example, for us, the second month is February, right? So it's the 15th day of the second month. And so actually, if we go back to chapter 12, verse 6, we see that the Passover, which culminated in the Exodus, that it was on the 14th day of this month, which was the month before. Right, so the first month, the 14th day of the month. And then so now we're the 15th day of the second month or the next month. And so it's been about a month or a month and 1 day, depending on how you count it. Okay, so just something interesting there for us to keep in mind. Second thing there in verse 1, it says that Israel came to the wilderness of Sin. That just coincidentally sounds like the English word sin. Now, ironically, they are indeed going to sin in the wilderness. They're going to sin by the grumbling. But actually, the word sin here is just from the Hebrew word that sounds like sin. Okay, so it actually is not called the wilderness of sin because they sin there. But ironically, they do sin by their grumbling. But what really is the problem with grumbling? I mean, sometimes we just need to let off some steam, right? It seems like maybe it could be therapeutic. What is the problem with grumbling? Well, again, that's what we're going to look at this morning. And so the first point is that grumbling breeds discontentment. Grumbling breeds discontentment. So why did the people of Israel grumble? Well, they grumbled because they were hungry, right? And this is not just like fourth meal hungry. You know, have you seen like the Taco Bell commercials where you need to have that fourth meal at 10 o'clock at night? We're so used to eating like every 3, 4, 5 hours that if we haven't eaten after 5 hours, then we're hungry. But I think they were more hungry than that. We don't know exactly how long they had gone without eating. We do know that before they came to Mara in the previous account in chapter 15, that it had been 3 days since they had drank water. And so they certainly have been in some very dire circumstances. Okay, so I think we can imagine that they've become quite hungry. But here's a lesson for us. Just because our bellies grumble doesn't mean that we have to grumble. Just because our bellies grumble doesn't mean that we have to. Of course, the same is true for the people of Israel. It certainly would have been better if the people of Israel had trusted the Lord to provide. Just as he did at Mara, right? And this is something we see again and again and again. The Lord provides for the people, and yet they still grumble against him. And they show a lack of trust. So it would have been better for them to have trusted in the Lord to provide, for them to have considered what God's purpose was in it all, right? Recognizing that God has a purpose for everything that he brings us through. And indeed, it would have been entirely appropriate for them to cry out to God, right? Of course, they're not necessarily to keep their anguish inside, but it's a matter of what do you do with it? What do you do with it? They could have. It certainly would have been appropriate for them to cry out to the Lord and say, "Oh Lord, we are so hungry. Please provide something for us." But instead, they grumbled. There is quite a difference. And the grumbling bred discontentment. So look at verses 2 through 3. The whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the people of Israel said to them, "Would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full. For you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill the whole assembly with hunger." It's easy for us to see how this can be a vicious cycle, right? You have this, you have grumbling, which leads to discontentment, which leads to more grumbling, and it just goes on and on and on. So we have to be careful to nip it in the bud, because grumbling can really cripple a person. Grumbling can cripple an assembly, a church. And sadly, our grumbling can be about things about a million times less severe than something like starvation. Over the past 10 plus years that I've served in churches, I've heard a decent amount of grumbling or heard about grumbling. That's just something that's common. But I think 99% of the grumbling that I've heard about. In churches, and not just my own churches, but other churches, it's about personal preferences. It's not gospel-related issues. And so something that I have, you've probably heard me say this, I've said this many times, is that I think a huge problem, just in the church at large, churches all over, is that we have this tendency to take ourselves too seriously and not take the gospel seriously enough. And that's a perfect scenario for grumbling, right? When we take ourselves too seriously and don't take the gospel seriously enough, it's something that ought to be flip flop, right? If we focus on the main thing, and if we really take the gospel seriously, then there's not going to be much time or concern about grumbling. Grumbling does not have to distract us from the gospel, because we can choose not to grumble. And again, this applies to our personal lives, it applies in the workplace, right? All kinds of things to grumble about in the workplace, all kinds of things to grumble about in our own lives, in our families, in our churches, in our country. You can fill in the blank, but we can choose not to grumble. And avoid this vicious cycle, this vicious cycle of grumbling and discontentment, and just the deep hole that it leads us into. Another part of that vicious cycle, this vicious cycle of grumbling, is delusion. So look again at verse 3. The people of Israel said to them, "Would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full." Just pause right there. When we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full. You know, the grass is always greener on the other side, isn't it? You know, and oftentimes the other side is the future, right? So oftentimes we say, okay, we're just longing for something to change, whether it's in your financial situation, your career, or maybe something to do with church, or again, fill in the blank, or something with our country, right? We long for something better. And of course, there's nothing wrong with longing for something better, but that's just an example to us that sometimes we miss out on what God is doing in the present, because the grass is always greener on the other side. If such and such happens, then things will be better. So sometimes it's the future, but oftentimes the greener grass is in the past, right? We look back on the past and we think, oh man, things were so good back then. And it's really delusional. It can be delusional in both directions when we look in the future, but especially when we look to the past, oftentimes we can kind of have this kind of selective memory. So the people of Israel, they're looking back and saying, oh man, back when we were slaves in Egypt, you remember how we'd sit around the pot and we'd have bread and meat to the full? I mean, make it sound like they were having some kind of Super Bowl party or something, right? But that was quite selective. I mean, goodness, they were slaves in Egypt. But we can have that tendency too, can't we? We look back and we remember all the good things. Oh, all the good things, go back to that. But we forget about, the challenges. And we think that the challenges that we might face in our own lives today are unique, but they're not. And so we can have this kind of selective memory. I think I've shared with you before about how my dad had this shirt. It said, "The older I get, the better I was." Right? And so, any of you who played sports back in high school, progressively, you were better and better. I mean, goodness, you should be playing the Super Bowl today, right? But we can have this kind of selective memory where we look back in the past and the grass is greener. And so we have to be aware of that. We have to be aware of that. And this, of course, all comes back to this idea of discontentment. Right? When we have something that is a discomfort to us, we don't have to be discontent, right? We don't have to be discontent. But when we grumble, that breeds discontentment. And when we grumble, oftentimes it goes hand in hand with, oh, the grass is greener on the other side. Whether we're looking back to the past or looking to the future, we can have this kind of delusion. And we have a discontentment that comes from our grumbling. And so, of course, there's wisdom in the scriptures telling us to not grumble. And we look at the example here of the people of Israel, and we see that they fell into a trap here as they grumbled against the Lord. And so let's move on to the second point here, and that is that grumbling dishonors the Lord. And I kind of gave away, the text itself gives this away, that one reason why grumbling dishonors the Lord is because when we grumble, we really are grumbling against the Lord. And so I'm going to draw that out further, but let's go ahead and look at verses 6 through 7. So in verses 4 through 5, that's when the Lord says that he's going to rain bread from heaven, and he tells them to all, to each day gather a day's portion, but then on the sixth day to gather 2 days' worth, because they're not to gather on the Sabbath, and so this is a way for them to test. And we're going to talk more about that next week, because in the second half of chapter 16, we actually have the description of this very thing happening, and so we'll focus on that next week. But we move on to verses six through seven. And it says, "So Moses and Aaron said to the people of Israel, 'At evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against the Lord.' For what are we that you would, that you grumble against us? So, so first, we do see some familiar language in this passage. It says, you shall know that it was Yahweh. You shall know that it was the Lord, Yahweh, who brought you out of Egypt. Similarly, in Exodus 14:8, after the, this is the account of the Red Sea, and so, of course, the Red Sea was parted for the people of Israel, and then it came down upon the Egyptians, and it was said that this happened so that the Egyptians shall know that I am Yahweh, right? So you shall know that it was Yahweh, we see in our text this morning, but then earlier we see the Egyptians shall know that I am Yahweh. For Egypt, this knowledge of Yahweh, this knowledge of the great I am, came through judgment. But for Israel, it will come through grace. And specifically in the passage this morning, we see that this grace is manifested in the quail and in the manna. And here God's grace is especially poignant because in verse 7, Moses highlights how little the people of Israel deserve it. Because we see that their grumbling against Moses and Aaron was really against the Lord himself. And so they're grumbling against God. And yet, God shows them so much grace by hearing their grumbling and providing for them. So we see even more explicitly in verse 8 how their grumbling was, in fact, against the Lord. So at the end of verse 8, it says, because the Lord has heard your grumbling, that you grumble against him. What are we? Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord. Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord. And there's no doubt about it. This kind of grumbling, it dishonors the Lord, right? It dishonors the Lord for us to grumble against the one true and living God. But you might ask, how is it that they're grumbling against Moses and Aaron, really against the Lord? How does God come to that conclusion? Well, first, these leaders were put in place by God, right? These were the leaders that God had put in place over the people of Israel. And indeed, according to Romans 13, no authority exists that God has not put in place. And so, so whether it's, you know, government or local or church or your job or whatever it is, there is no authority put in place that God himself did not put there. Okay? Now, that doesn't mean that there's not evil leaders. There are evil leaders. In fact, when Paul wrote Romans 13, that was under the reign of Nero. And yet, he's saying to submit to these authorities because no authority exists that God has not put in place. And so there's a way in which we can even sit under some kind of authority that is not righteous, and yet we refrain from grumbling. Right? It doesn't mean that you can't object to something, but grumbling is a certain attitude of the heart, isn't it? And so we must not grumble, and we recognize that when we grumble. We grumble against maybe some person of leadership or authority. We're not off the hook just because we directed towards some particular person. It is as if we are grumbling against the Lord himself. I think this was especially true for Moses. You know, Moses being the prophet of God and the one who was to lead Israel spiritually. But I think there is even this broader application because God is sovereign over all things, over all people, and so really any time we grumble at all about anything to anyone, even to ourselves, if we have this kind of grumbling spirit, if we recognize, okay, God is sovereign and God is in control of this, then that means that our grumbling is a lack of faith. Right? It's kind of like when we worry, when we have anxiety, right? That's actually a sin against God because we're not trusting in him. So it's the same thing with grumbling. Whenever we grumble about whatever it might be in our lives, we're essentially grumbling against God who is sovereign over all things. And so that dishonors him, doesn't it? It dishonors him, well, because of everything I just said, but also if we go back to this verse, the letter D on our wall at home, I mean, there's a command given to us to not grumble, to do everything without grumbling or disputing. And so certainly when we break the Lord's commands, we dishonor him. But even as we dig deeper, we see why it is that grumbling dishonors the Lord. And in fact, if we go back to this letter D verse, verse from Philippians chapter 2 that I quoted, if we read it in its broader context, we actually see that it's the context is set within a recognition of the sovereignty of God. So it makes sense, right? That because God is sovereign, because God is working through all things, that we should not grumble. Let me go ahead and read that. And in fact, why don't you turn there with me to Philippians chapter 2. And we'll look at verses 12 through 15. Philippians 2, beginning in verse 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, this is Paul writing, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God, without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. And so we see right before our verse, in verse 14, right before this verse, do all things without grumbling or disputing, we see that God, the work that God does in us, this sanctification, it is indeed a work of the Lord, right? And it involves it'll involve discomfort, some stretching, even trials and tribulations. And so it's fitting that right on the heels of this statement concerning God's work within us, we have this command to do all things without grumbling or disputing. Right? You see that? So we see that Paul is pointing out that. This work of sanctification, this work that God is doing within us, it is a work of God that we ought to embrace, which we know that sanctification often includes all kinds of discomforts, all kinds of trials, right? And so right on the heels of that, right on the heels of Paul discussing God's work within us for our sanctification, that is, the part of our salvation that we are working out with fear and trembling, recognizing that it's God working within us, we're told, do all things without grumbling or disputing. So instead of dishonoring or disobeying the Lord, right? Instead of grumbling when things come our way that might be a discomfort to us, instead of grumbling, we are to embrace that as sanctification and say, okay, God is working in these things. He's working for his will, and he's working both to will and to work for his good pleasure. And so we recognize that we're sanctified by it, and we shine as lights in a dark world. Whenever we embrace these things and allow God to do his work, then we really do shine brightly in this dark world. So grumbling breeds discontentment. Grumbling dishonors the Lord. Those are some, I think, some key things that we see in this passage. And so as I bring this to a close, I want to point out that just we see the same thing in the account at Mara. We see that this miracle that God performs at Mara, that in it he shows both his glory and his grace. And we see it again in this passage. Time after time, God is showing to the people of Israel his glory and his grace. And so look at verses 9 through 12. Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, 'Come near before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling.'" And so, as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. Glory of the Lord. And the Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the grumbling of the people of Israel. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall be filled with bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.'" And so we see the glory of the Lord in this cloud. Right? Remember, there's the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night that is leading the people. And we see the glory of the Lord in the cloud, and we see his grace in this quail and the manna that's provided. Even as they grumble against the Lord, he gives them grace. Well, praise God, ultimately, his glory and grace can be found most fully in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who is the supreme manifestation of God to man. When we see in an Old Testament text like this, when we see God displaying his glory and his grace, it should make us immediately think about Jesus. I think of John 1:14, tells us, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." Right? God's glory and grace are seen most fully in Jesus Christ. In fact, this Jesus would later say of himself, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger." We're going to look at that passage more in depth next week as we talk more about the manna in particular. But Jesus says of himself, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger." And so when your stomach is grumbling, do not grumble against the Lord, but instead come to him in faith. Eat from the bread of life. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his glory, his grace, how we see this the supreme manifestation of God in God the Son, Jesus. We have a taste of it even here in Exodus as you display your glory and grace to the people of Israel. Oh God, may we not grumble against you. You are a good God, and you care for us, and you want to work in and through us in even difficult and uncomfortable situations and our trials and tribulations. And so when we feel uncomfortable, when we are facing difficulties, help us to not grumble. Help us to not fall into this trap of discontentment, of the grass is greener on the other side, of delusion, and of grumbling against you, our God. Help us to not dishonor you by grumbling against you, by indeed disobeying what you have commanded. And so, Lord, I pray that you will work on us from the inside out. And we thank you for your grace that you do so. And so we pray that you continue that in us, Lord. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Well, let's stand together as we sing, "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus." That is what everything in Scripture is pointing toward, and that's where we can find our satisfaction. And so as we sing together, if you'd like me to pray for you about anything or have any kind of decision to make, feel free to come forward at this time. You can always grab the after the service as well. So let's pray together.
So are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see.
Well, real quickly, Ronnie, come on up here. Want to introduce you all to Ronnie. I think most of you know Ronnie. It's been a couple of years now that you've been coming quite consistently and getting involved here at the church. He has not formally become a member, and he and I were just chatting the other day and started to talk about church membership. And I would like to recommend him this morning for church membership. Ronnie came to faith and was baptized many years ago, and I guess for some time wasn't involved in church, but he began coming here and getting involved again quite consistently just a couple of years ago, and I've just been very encouraged by him and am happy to recommend him to you for church membership. And so, all in favor of receiving Ronnie as a church member, would you raise your right hand? All opposed, same sign. Very good. And so, we welcome you to our family, and just a wonderful opportunity and privilege for us to encourage Ronnie and be encouraged by him, and for us to hold one another accountable. And so, give him a pat on the back, shake his hand, and we're glad to have him. Let me dismiss us with doxology from Ephesians 3:20-21. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.